Thank you for asking that question. So, GGGI is an intergovernmental organization. We are like the United Nations, if you like, that we are serving our member governments. And we work on both policy, green growth policy, helping governments chart a way to a greener economic model. And the United Nations does that as well. So we're a bit similar to UNDP or UNEP that work on a green economy. But then we also follow up by working on financing, basically on how governments can implement these green growth policies and plans by projects, investment projects, that we help originate and develop and structure. And then we help mobilize finance. So that financing side is almost more like the World Bank or the MDBs, except of course we don't have money. So sometimes I joke with our government counterparts, unfortunately we don't have money, and they agree. And then they say, but that also means we don't have to sell you any World Bank loans. We can find the right investors for you that ever, whatever suits the governments and the project best. So here in Seoul, we have about 100 staff. We now have about 500 people, staff and consultants, and 80% of them are embedded in more than 30 country offices. And in each of these countries, we have staff sitting in the ministries of finance, ministries of planning, ministries of environment, directly supporting our member governments. So that's quite unique. Yes, so our work is primarily in developing and emerging economies. And the biggest success we had last year, for example, was that we worked with the government of Peru to help them issue their first sustainable bond and their first social bond. We helped develop the sustainable bond framework. We are a member of the International Capital Market Association, so we use their guidelines, and we work with the government to specify everything from the categories where the money can be used, the processes on how the bond can be set up, and so on. And then the government adopted our green bond or sustainable bond framework, and a week later, the Minister of Finance issued the first green bond, and it raised $3 billion for the sustainable bond, and then 2 weeks later, €1 billion for the social bond. And that is then the largest thematic bond in Latin America. It's also the largest sustainable bond ever issued by a sovereign government. So we do not very often work on technology that is not yet ready to be rolled out. But in a few cases, we work on more advanced technology, and probably the best example of that is green hydrogen. Because we know that in the end, for countries like Korea to decarbonize, particularly heavy industry, we cannot do everything through solar and wind. We'll have to find ways to use hydrogen. Hydrogen is already used in the industry, but most of it now comes is produced using fossil fuel. So it's not a very green way of producing that. When we produce hydrogen from renewable energy, could be hydropower or wind or geothermal, then we call it green hydrogen. The problem is that right now, such green hydrogen is still more expensive than the regular way of producing it in Busan from gas, for instance, right? So we work with KOGAS, Korea's gas company, and with a number of private sector interests here in Korea to try and develop such projects in Indonesia or in India or in places where there is enough renewable energy, to try and bring the price down and to try and work on ways to transport that green hydrogen to Korea. And that will take some time. So, renewable energy is already cheaper than coal in many cases. So we can tell most of our countries they should move away from coal to renewable energy because it's cheaper. That's not yet the case for green hydrogen. So over the next 10 years or so, we have to work to bring the price down or find some subsidies initially, as was the case for solar and wind initially too. And then indeed, once that works, this could become a great opportunity for Korea to import no longer the natural gas that you, the fossil fuel gas that you import from Qatar and UAE and Australia, but to import green hydrogen instead. Well, there are opportunities to reduce emissions, of course, in developed countries, in Europe, in Korea, but since quite a bit of action has already been taken, the prices of reducing emissions more are getting higher and higher. So it's potentially cheaper to reduce those emissions in developing countries. They might even indeed become carbon sinks if they rehabilitate their mangroves or replant the trees. But those governments often lack the money to do so. So for mitigation, green ODA can help develop mitigation in developing countries with money from developed countries, in part because, you know, those developing countries, particularly the least developed countries, they haven't caused the climate problem, right? If we see historically who have produced the most emissions, of course, Korea can say that you are a latecomer, a new, if you like, country. If 50 years ago, almost all those emissions came from Europe and in North America. But right now, China is the largest emitter by far, and other emerging economies who have done really very well, like Korea, have also racked up a pretty large amount of emissions. So there is also a moral debt, and countries like Korea, who've now become a leader in Asia in taking strong action at home through the Green New Deal, through the commitments to reduce emissions here, I think can also be a leader in Asia and use green ODA to share Korean expertise and technology. So ODA was used by Korea to build coal-fired power plants in other Asian countries. I mean, China, Japan, Korea were the major exporters, both of the technology and supporting it through ODA. Now the government has said, okay, let's stop coal-fired power plants internationally. I think that's a great decision. Of course, some industries will lose jobs, but on the other hand, you can then export other green technologies that Korea is also very strong in, whether it's batteries or electric cars, or whether it's going to be wind turbines, where I think Korean heavy industry has a real opportunity to produce them as well. I think ITMOs, internationally transferred mitigation outcomes, are actually a wonderful opportunity both for developing countries and for developed countries. When Korea increased the commitment to reduce emissions at home up to 40%, so before in the National Assembly, when the climate law passed, the National Assembly had said we will reduce emissions to 32%. But as IPCC has said, in line with net zero, countries should really reduce their emissions by 45 to 50%. The president made, I think, a courageous decision to increase Korea's emission reduction to 40%. But I think most people would believe that the addition from 32 to 40% may not be achieved at home, but will have to be found through international cooperation. So Korea will have to pay developing countries, will have to buy ITMOs for the additional 8%. We find that many of our members in developing and emerging economies are very interested in selling those carbon credits. But there's a big gap in capacity. So from Indonesia to other countries, yes, they would like to sell carbon credits, but they don't have the right governance. They don't have necessarily a good database. We call it a MRV, Monitoring, Reporting, and Verification System. And they don't have the projects ready. So actually, GGI has quite a large team, we call it our carbon pricing unit, that works currently with 12 countries, probably expanded with another handful soon, to support them in building capacity to be able to trade so that they can be partners for Korea or Norway or Sweden or other countries who want to buy. So once we have set up the institutions that allow this, and once, say, Indonesia agrees with Korea that they are willing to sell carbon credits. So we imagine, frankly, that's what we're working on this year, that GGI could be a carbon transaction platform, that we could be a broker, maybe even a trader of those carbon credits between Indonesia and Korea, that once the Indonesian and Korean governments agree on the terms, And we can work with project developers in Indonesia to develop projects that we can offer through our carbon transaction platform. And Korean companies can buy those credits if the Korean government allows them to be registered under the Korean ETS. Most of this is still an idea. I proposed to our council that GGI could develop this last October, and the initial response from the council was positive. So this year we've set up a task force that I'm chairing to develop this idea and to consult our members how to do this, because obviously it's quite complicated. In June we'll organize a workshop here in Korea, or virtual, to bring all the experts from our member countries together, and then to come up with a proposal for our council by the end of the year. GGI as an organization could be the kind of platform through which these different countries can try to find terms that they can agree on. And we have quite a bit of technical expertise. We've been working on this since 2019. So far, mostly funded through Norway and Sweden, and soon Germany. Korea has come a little bit slower to this particular subject. Japan, for instance, has already made MOUs with quite a few countries, so under what kind of conditions they might be willing to trade. So yes, we're hoping that probably the next government probably will take the opportunity to work with us and catch up, so that Korea can also find potential trading partners and discuss those terms. So yes, we strongly believe that progress can be made through a combination of both the policy side and investment projects. Sometimes there are still barriers to investment because governments have limits on investment in renewable energy, for instance, or sometimes there are still fossil fuel subsidies that hamper investment. So being able to work with government to create what we call an enabling environment, to have the right policies in place, sometimes more broad overarching policies, but sometimes quite specific ones on what should be the feed-in tariff for biogas, for instance, to enable, in Vietnam, for instance, the government wanted us to work on using more of the biomass waste from agriculture that now was going to landfills or being burned into biomass waste to energy projects, either through biogas or through in sugar factories to be put into, well, to basically to burn the bagasse. Now we found that the feed-in tariff that the government had for biomass waste to energy, 5.5 cents per kilowatt, was just too low. At that level, we couldn't see any private investment going there. So we wrote a note for government and recommended it should go up by 1 or 2 cents. And then the government did that, and as a result, there is a lot more private investment. So that's a good example of how government policies can be enabling private investment. So I believe that coal in Asia is possibly the most important subject for achieving the Paris Agreement in the coming decade. How quickly Asia can transition out of coal, and how quickly we can find alternatives for coal. And it's a very sensitive issue, we know, but I think avoiding it is just not possible. So we're going to have to discuss that openly.